focusing on the lives, experiences, and viewpoints of motherlode women, the show features a rotating cast of four women of all ages and from all walks of life. Quick, upbeat, and fast-paced with a variety of topics, this one-hour show will be aired live Monday, Wednesday, and Friday at 8:30 a.m. Tune in. It's Just Between Us. Good morning and welcome to Just Between Us, a talk show for ladies and even gentlemen on occasion. That we have some great guys that come and join us now and then. This morning we want to open up and we want to wish everybody in Boston, we want to give them our blessings and our prayers, and our thoughts are with them. And especially after what's transacted this morning, it's good news, and it's also sad because a police officer was killed and one is fighting for his life. So let's just hope this madness stops. I'm Susie, and
I'm Pat from Sutter Creek,
and I'm Gail from Sutter Creek,
and I'm Martha from Ione in Jackson.
That a girl.
Thank you.
So let's pick our first two topics.
Okay.
And
you give them to her.
Okay.
You pick them up and
pick
give
them
up to
and
her.
There you go. Oh, here. Okay, I'll give one to you. Okay, go ahead.
Okay, we'll get it together. Wait, here in just a minute.
All right. No, you're fine.
Give her another one. Give her another one.
Okay.
Give her another one.
There's two.
All right. And then the first topic
is
if you can read the first topic.
Being a good person.
Number three.
Okay. Why do you feel there are some that just can't reach out and be good no matter what the circumstances are?
And the second topic.
Oh, there's your second one. And the second topic is surroundings.
Number four.
There are some that make you remove your shoes when you enter their home. How would you handle this situation?
Take off my shoes.
I know people like that. Hey, we're going to take a short break, and we're going to keep our shoes on, and we'll be right back. Just Between Us, a spontaneous, intuitive live television show with topics that are intended to inspire, delight, educate, and encourage. And now back to Just Between Us. Welcome back to Just Between Us and ladies.
Okay, first topic, being a good person, why do you feel that there are some that just can't reach out and be good no matter what the circumstances are?
I think it's just because they're angry. They're just angry people, and they...
And jealous.
Yeah, a lot of times it's a combination of a lot of things. Sometimes that they're angry because they can't have what they want, or they're envious of other people, or it's not their nature. They're selfish. And there are people like that out there, and what can you do? I mean, nothing. That's just their personality.
You know, if it's not one of my friends, I, Martha Perez, don't care.
Yeah.
You know, if it's one of my friends, I will sit down with her, and I will talk to her. And try to get her back into the good mood, you know, where she's supposed to be. Because sometimes we get off our track. All of us do. I know I've done little things that...
Yeah, but Martha, there are some people that, no matter what,
they just
can't be receptive to the happiness or whatever.
Positive. They can't be receptive of positive. They're just negative people, I guess, right?
Right, and I agree. Some people are selfish. They just want what they can have, and they don't want to share. They don't want to, you know, it's mine. I earned it. I'm not going to let anybody else spend my money.
Right.
We have a lot of that.
But haven't you seen we saw it at 9/11. We saw it during the hurricanes and all of the things. We're seeing it. We're going to see this now with Boston and the explosion in Texas. We're going to see. You see the humanity. You see that there's more good people out there. But then we've also seen the scams. The people that have said, "Send me money for the hurricane victims or 9/11," and what they do. They scam people. So
you know,
you see,
there's
there
a website.
Ugly people
there's
like
a
that.
Website that I found yesterday, FBI.gov, and all kinds of information are in there. So if anybody out there, you know, wants that site, just go to FBI.gov.
Yes.
You know, there's a whole bunch of information for people to get educated in scams and on just things that people do.
Right.
And you have the ability on that site to actually report things. I actually filed something with the FBI because I got an email the other day that, you know, the extension that's on your email, it's .gov.edu, .com. Well, I got one that had a .gov and then another .. So my suspicion of it was this person was using that government extension to fool people.
Yes.
And so I actually did report it to the FBI because I thought that went a little bit beyond the pale. I mean, I get, you know, you get scam mail all the time, but that was unusual.
You know, the unfortunate thing that there's genetics and then there's environment. And there are genetic things and then there are your environment as you're growing up, what your parents teach you, not necessarily what they teach you by telling you, but what they teach you by letting a child observe the parent. And if you think about and if you talk to people and kind of get into their background, you'll kind of understand why they're the way they are, because it's very interesting, because usually it isn't what they say about their parents or who raised them, it's what they don't say. And then you know that there are gaps missing. And it's very, I mean, and you can overcome environment much more easily than you can overcome genetics.
Right.
And because that's just kind of the way it is.
Unfortunately, there's people that are raised, you know, they're raised one way, and it's very, very hard for them to break break that. And it's not really their fault, but I think that when you get to a certain age, you can see certain traits.
Common sense has to kick in.
And you know that certain behavior is unbecoming, and certain behavior is just not receptive by other people. So therefore, you can turn around and you can start trying to think a different way and take a different avenue, you know, and know. But there are people, I know there are, I've known one or two, that no matter what, when you think that they have just mellowed out and they're good, they do something or say something vicious again. And, you know, you can't.
The eternal rebel. I mean,
you know, you just have to laugh. You just have to laugh about people like that, because it ain't nothing I can do about it. And as long as I'm happy,
then there you go.
And if it's my friend, I will help my friend. If it's somebody I don't care about,
well, then you just let it go.
I just let it go because I just don't put attention to what they have to say, because it's not important to me.
I agree.
Hello.
You have to let certain
You're the weakest link. Goodbye.
There you go.
Well, I think you just eventually, if it's somebody you know, you kind of have to look at and say, how important is this person to me?
Exactly. You're right.
That they're affecting my life adversely.
You're right.
And so, should I worry
about? Do I really want to deal with this, or do I really just want to move on?
Yeah. Well, you're right, Pat. You're right. And that's what we're going to do. We're going to move on to the next topic.
Okay, move on. All right.
What do you think, Jackie?
Okay,
good so far?
Surroundings.
Yeah. What's that topic?
Surroundings. There are some that make you remove your shoes when you enter their home. How would you handle the situation? Well, my theory is that when you go to somebody's house,
you follow the rules.
Kowtow to their rules. And, I mean, I go up to Portland, and my kids don't wear shoes in the house, and they chose to do that once they had young children crawling around, and then they were amazed at how much cleaner their house stayed, so it has continued.
Wow. Yeah, oh,
and,
that's nice.
And
I wouldn't tell you about my rules in my house.
Yeah, well, I mean, the thing is, if that's what they want, and we're invited, I kind of think that that's...
Pat, I'm so silly, I'm sorry.
No, that's okay, but I mean, it's kind of like, you know, we all have... different and, you know, I mean...
Regulations.
It's like, I try to tell
my husband... We're in California.
You have construction work boots on. It would help if you knock the mud off.
Yeah.
And he said, I try, but it's all in the grooves.
Yeah, you know, I know. It's
hard. Yeah, my floors up at my place are, you know, they're just a disaster because we have so much property and dirt and everything else, and especially when it snows and stuff.
And when the dog comes in from outside.
When it snows and stuff, you know, the whole big thing. But, you know, you go with the flow. Personally, would I be insulted? No. I know people that when you go to their house, as a matter of fact, they have little slippers that you can put on if you'd like to do that.
I thought it was some kind of religion that people do that.
Well, there's certain respect things. The Japanese do it out of respect.
Right.
You remove your shoes when you enter. There's also, I can't remember.
Did you say Chinese or Japanese?
Japanese.
Japanese. Yeah. I have a girlfriend that is Japanese, and she doesn't make me take her much.
Well, you don't have to.
American Japanese.
Oh. Yeah.
But when I lived in Hawaii, I mean, nobody wears
shoes
in the house.
Mm-hmm.
That's and correct. We lived over the Pali from Honolulu. So, I mean, it was not out in the country. It was in
we're
the
not
town.
Japanese, and my grandkids don't wear shoes in the house. They just like to wear socks because I had hardwood floors.
Yeah.
So they always
slide. Yes. There you go. There you go. As a matter of fact, I was watching, what's the program? It's on HGTV. It's, you know, the real estate shows. And there's one, Buying or Selling Hawaii. And the realtor, everybody, you watch them, they're all barefooted.
Yes.
It's really funny. Cool. I think that some people might be, think, you know, like insulted, like, well, I'm not dirty. You know, my shoes are not dirty.
Oh, they are.
Well, whatever. But yeah, yes, absolutely. But I think that when you, out of courtesy, when you go to somebody's home, I think it's only proper if they say, please remove it. It's the same thing like some people say, please do not smoke in my house.
Yeah.
You know, that's it. There's no smoking in my home. And, you know, it's no different if they want you to take off their your shoes.
It's funny because everybody has different customs. In Mexico, when you go to church, you cover your head.
Right.
Well, that's,
you
know. All Catholics did that until, 1965 or 60s?
Yeah, I remember.
Was it 62? You know, somewhere around in there, because I remember that, and then they discontinued eating, not eating meat on Friday, and I wonder if all those people
when I was a kid, I always grew up with a hat.
There's
with a veil.
So many, so many customs in different ways. So I guess that when you go to somebody's home, you should have the respect if they ask you to do something.
And you have to be careful. Like if you travel to a foreign country, I think it's one country, and I'm not going to mention because I don't know for sure, but you can't show them the bottom of your feet. Those are fighting words, as they say.
And if you go to visit the Pope, I mean, people, out of respect for them, the women will cover their hair or wear a mantilla or something like that.
Right.
And I don't know what the reasoning is, but that's what we did when we were kids.
Well, I think what it was that it was, I think it was because the women in the biblical days, they all wore like the mantilla. And then it just was handed down that women would cover.
Well, I know the Muslim religion doesn't really like women to show their hair because they feel that's sort of giving a part of them away. You know, it's a very personal thing.
Right.
It's, you know, and that's why they wear the burqas.
Take it.
You know, to cover their
body.
But exposing your hair, or you see a lot of the younger women wearing scarves, covering their hair.
Jewish religion.
I'm so glad I'm in the
men
U.S.
Men wear yarmulkes.
Right.
Yarmulkes. What is a yarmulke?
A yarmulke.
A small beanie.
The beanie
that the Jewish women wear when they enter.
Matter of fact, yesterday,
the synagogue.
Yesterday, watching the church services from Boston, there were a few men that had the yarmulke on. So because it was an interfaith, for everybody,
so many religions and so many customs that you don't know who's what, when, how, and that's the best thing about the United States, where you have the freedom to do whatever we want,
you don't want to. We're going to pick two new topics, ladies.
Okay, give her the topics.
Okay.
Please, just turn it and she'll take them.
There you go.
Oh, there's one. And here's two.
Oops, sorry. We want to do a free-for-all, I think, this time. That a girl.
There we go.
All right. Okay, and the topic?
The first one is a free-for-all.
Okay. And the second one?
All right, the second one, music.
Number three.
Do you feel that music is universal and makes a grand statement?
Yes. Well, we're going to make a grand statement by going away and coming back in a few moments, so stay with us. Just Between Us. We'll say good morning. Good morning.
Okay.
And welcome back. We want to say good morning to Carol this morning.
Yes, Carol Harper. Good morning.
Good morning, Carol. We love you. Okay, Pat, sorry.
Okay. Topic number one, music. Number three, do you feel that music is universal and makes a grand statement?
Oh, absolutely.
I couldn't live without music. I wake up in the morning and my grandkids make fun of me. But
what is your favorite music?
Oh, rock and roll, of course.
See, me too. I'm a 50s, 60s,
and I like country music.
I do too.
I'm probably one of the only Mexican people that like country music. I love country music.
Oh, you go.
My grandkids hate me.
No. When San Diego
and like, I got to have my country music.
Go to San Diego and places. There's a lot of Mexican people that love country and Western music. And I'll tell you another music that I like. I like the Latin music.
Oh yeah,
I love
salsa music.
Salsa, I love that.
Zumba. Yeah. Oh my God, I went to take a class at Zumba, at the Hub up here, from TSPN.
How'd you do?
Oh my God, I thought I was gonna die.
Yeah, it's too.
It's intensive. It's intensive, but it feels so good, you know.
Yeah. Well.
Yeah. It does.
Yeah.
Mine's not Zumba. Mine's Boomba, because I go Boomba on the floor.
I love all kinds of music, and I used to try and expose the grandkids to it, even things like klezmer. Klezmer music it came from a Jewish background overseas, and it's really lively music and very, you know, very exciting. So I think each culture has its own music.
Oh, definitely.
My family is Irish, and so I love a lot of the Irish songs, but many of the Irish songs that we have here are American Irish songs. But
well, there's a few people that have authentic Irish music. It's very pretty. They've got some beautiful, beautiful songs out there that are just
so like Enya.
Enya, beautiful voice.
Well, one thing you think about it is that, think about, like, I remember when I was a teenager and the Beatles and I remember the things being sung in German. Oh, they actually did, because they performed in Germany so often before they got to be famous. And not too long ago, we were listening on the radio, we were going somewhere, and Ted says, "What is that?" And I said, "Oh, that's Paul McCartney." And he says, "But it's in a different language." And I said, "Yeah, he's singing in German." And it was one of their early favorite songs. And the other thing is that, I mean, I think of all, I remember when we went to Japan and there would be our American stars singing in a different language.
Wow.
You know, and you know, and it was interesting because it seemed to have a thread that when we went to Japan, they would talk about our American pop stars, and I can remember being in Europe and hearing people talk about
things. Yeah, there's some people, like what's his name, Hasselhoff? He is
David Hasselhoff.
Huge hit in over in Europe and stuff. I mean, he's a big rock star. Let me ask you, Stones or Beatles?
Probably Stones.
Stones or Beatles?
Oh, Beatles.
Beatles, baby.
Stones. Rock on. Patty and I
were
Stones. Yeah, I love the Rolling Stones.
But I'm older than you guys.
And the big lips.
No, I don't like those. No, you have to say, you have to listen to the Stones. You can't look at them now.
The whole package. A total
mess. But I'll tell you what's beautiful. When you hear Jennifer Lopez or Mark Anthony or Pitbull when they sing in Spanish.
Oh, it's beautiful.
See, I like mariachi music too.
I love mariachi music too.
My mother had mariachi music on all the time. She used to listen to Johnny Canales on every Saturday afternoon.
Oh my gosh.
Oh my God. Yes, that's going back.
Of course.
That's going back a few years.
And one of the things I think that you can, if you go somewhere in the world and then you hear somebody listening to a Beatles song or a Stones song or, you know, Jennifer Lopez or something, and you're halfway around the world, and all of a sudden, you know, you'll hear somebody humming this, and it's like, we have a connection. Oh, yeah, that was my... And then that kind of transcends, you know, cultural differences, political differences, and things like that.
I think when you travel, it's like, you know, try to eat the foods of the region to see what it's like. Music is the same way. Listen to some of the music from the region, and you learn a lot more about a country.
Yeah, it's a lot of fun. You know, there's so much out there. I can't believe you're a Stones fan. Look at Pat. Come on, Pat.
Rock on, baby.
Go on, girl.
She's in disguise.
I'm in disguise.
My brother has seen them like three times, and he took his daughter with them one time because she just loves them. I mean, their generation just goes down and down and down. But it was funny because the other day my grandson said to me, he goes, "Noni, I'm taking up the guitar." I thought, oh, here we go. And so now he's into Huey Lewis.
Oh, cool. I love Huey Lewis.
I do too. And the power of love. He's trying to learn that on his guitar, the power of love. So Cam is very good friends with Huey Lewis. So I told Cam, I says, oh, you got to tell Huey, he's got a big fan out there. Little John wants to learn to play the guitar and play some of his music. But I also like George Thorogood. I don't know if you know who George Thorogood is.
He's interesting. I love you.
See, Patty knows how to get down.
Yeah. I can tell you a quick story. Is that Ted and I were getting ready to go to a Stones concert, and our younger son was at he was over at Berkeley at Cal, and he called me up one Sunday afternoon, and I said, I cannot talk to you. We're leaving to go to see the Stones. And his first thing out of the mouth, you didn't buy me a ticket? I said, no.
At least he didn't say you're too old.
Surprised they didn't say, oh, you have kidney stones. No, I'm seeing the Rolling Stones.
No, my children would never think that I'm too old for this.
Good. I'm glad. Because those, I have to admit, those guys can still, they can still rock on. Ugly, but they can rock on.
Yeah. I don't necessarily think they're all ugly, except that Keith Richards looked like he died and was embalmed 20 years ago.
Yeah, and they dug him back up for some reason and threw a guitar in his hand. But he still rocks on.
He can play.
They're the educated group. I mean, the Beatles were not educated.
Now, I'll tell you who's very educated is Mick Jagger.
He graduated from the London School of Economics.
Absolutely. Yeah. And he's the one that made them all of their money because he knew what
to
do with
them. Invest it, yes.
So he's not a dumbbell.
Next topic is free-for-all.
It's our free-for-all. And Martha, you wanted to do a free-for-all today.
Yes. Tomorrow I will be going to San Jose. This will be my second time. If you guys remember, 2 years ago, there was a gentleman that got beat up at the Dodgers Stadium at the Giants game. Yes, and he got so beat up that, you know, he's been down for two years, you know, and we don't think that he will ever be able to be normal again because he has TBI, traumatic brain injury.
Right.
So,
a very brave man, Brian Stowe, is very brave.
And his family. I really, really think that the family, the Stowes, are a very strong family because I don't know how I would deal if anything like that were. I cannot even imagine anything like that happening to my son and have to be there 24/7, you know, to take care of him.
It's a tough road.
It's a big job. Right. And all of the people they have, you know, family that have to take care of them, I admire them because, you know,
my heart goes out not only to them and whatever, but I mean, all of us that are Giants fans, but people that are Dodgers fans, the pain that they went through and they did
it wasn't their fault, you know.
Absolutely not. They did a benefit for him and then they allowed Brian's son, was it last year or the year before, to throw out the ball for him because he couldn't throw the ball out.
Yeah.
And
it was so emotional for me to watch.
Oh my God. I know. It's
when Brian, you know, took the ball and put it towards the camera so that, you know, it looked like his son was taking it so he could throw it.
Right.
Oh my God. I was like, oh, because I know the family. It's just so emotional.
Yeah.
Tomorrow we'll be together and we'll do a walk through traumatic brain injury.
Oh, wonderful.
You know? And so there's going to be a lot of people there. And they all do their own walk for different people.
Causes.
Wonderful. So we do a fundraiser, you know. And then after the walk, we get together at a friend's house. And his whole family comes and stays with us and has lunch, you know.
We talk about the whole crew.
Yeah,
right?
I'll be cooking for them this year too. But
isn't it fun to do things like that? Gail was talking about, and Donna will probably be on and talk about it at the end of May. There's a special walk for disabled veterans.
Yes, that's correct.
And Donna and I both belong to the Wounded Warrior Project, so we're both big advocates of that. And I think now, after this Boston, we're seeing the doctors there. One of the doctors served in Afghanistan for a year, and he said, I'm seeing injuries that I had to handle in Afghanistan.
Yeah.
So Afghanistan has, and the Middle East has come home to Boston.
I know.
And two brothers that were running the race, both of them lost their right leg. both brothers. So there's a lot of people out there that are going. We need to support these people, and I applaud you, Martha, for supporting Brian.
Oh, thank you. It's my pleasure to do it. I enjoy.
It's wonderful
being able to do things for other people, just to give them a little hope. You know, we have a group on Facebook. It's called 5 Minutes to Honor Brian Stowe, and there's a group of us. I mean, there's people from Hawaii, there's people from Florida, there's people from all over, you know, and some of them fly into San Jose, and we all get together.
It's just
very emotional.
Yeah. Well, then, I know it was very emotional for the team, too. To know that this young man went all the way down.
It's good for me because I have a TBI, too, you know, because I had my brain aneurysm.
Right.
So we kind of all kind of talk about it, and we all support each other.
Wonderful.
Because everybody had something, you know, going on.
Okay.
Do we have...
We have the last two topics. One's going to be a free-for-all that Gail and Pat are going to work on. Okay. And then our last one.
A new world. Roll the die, please.
Yes, ma'am. Number five.
Number five. Due to store cameras, pictures were helpful in obtaining evidence in the Boston Marathon bombing. Do you now feel it is necessary or infringing on your rights?
To have more
cameras. This is the store campus.
Okay, and then
all right,
we have,
and then we have another free-for-all.
Okay, great.
That's right. We can't talk about it. I'm so anxious. I want to talk about it already.
Well, you know what? We may have to just take the free-for-all and continue that.
Yes.
We're going to take a short break, and we'll be right back.
Just Between Us, a spontaneous, intuitive live television show with topics that are intended to inspire, delight, educate, and encourage.
Welcome back. I'm Susie from Volcano.
I'm Pat from Sutter Creek.
I'm Gail from Sutter Creek.
I'm Martha from my own induction.
That a girl.
Okay.
Patty, we're going to go with your free-for-all, honey. So you...
Oh, okay. So we don't want to do this one?
We're going to... Yeah, we'll do that after.
Oh, okay.
We're going to do free-for-all first.
All right. So the free-for-all. What do you think of Congress voting down the extended...
The gun control?
The gun control, the... background checks and things like that, because basically a lot of the representatives that voted no talked like they were going to vote yes. Mm-hmm. And then they had polled throughout the United States. They did independent polls, and 94% of people that were polled in the United States agreed that we should have this. And then there was the vote was such that they needed two more.
They need 60.
They need 60, and they got
54.
What it was that, and some of and the thing is, some of the Republicans, for the most part, voted against it.
Right.
The Democrats, for the most part, voted for it.
But
there were people who
flip flopped.
And basically, they were saying that they thought it was a good idea right up until the vote.
I think Harry Reid was one of them. It's because they're backed by gun lobbyists.
Right, and their money is funded from the NRA.
I think the sad thing about the whole thing is in that, and we know it's your right to bear arms, whatever. However, California has adopted a very, very, I think, a good, and it's pretty strict background check and ways of obtaining firearms. Now, I know we have a lot of gun violence in the state of California, Stockton,
just a little,
all places like that.
Just a little.
I think we got to go back to square one. And I'm not going to say people kill people, guns don't kill people. Okay, I'm not going to go there. But what I'm going to tell you is that no matter what you put into place, there are millions of guns on the black market.
Exactly.
And they come in from Mexico, they come down from Canada. You can get a gun anywhere, okay? I think they said there's about 30 million guns that are traded, obtained, this and that and whatever. So let's put things in perspective. It's like the narcotic issue.
Sure.
You're never going to control it.
No.
Okay. But doing the background checks, and for people like myself, if I wanted to go purchase a gun, I have no problem in going through the steps and going through what I have
when
to do.
You're legally, when you're going to do legally,
absolutely.
You know, why should I worry about, you know, what my background is?
Right.
You know, another thing that I have always thought since, you know, since I came to the country and I got my own gun, I always felt that they should do another test, a mental test. You know, to know what should be required. You know, that should be one of the first requirements to see your background into your health mentally.
I had a real problem with the whole thing when it was turned down because one of the congresspersons said that he felt Obama used the people from Sandy Hook as props.
Yeah.
He didn't say pawns, he used the word props, which I thought was way, way over the top.
No, I don't
think
that.
I think they have an absolute right to appear and give their side just as much as the NRA does.
I mean, they're the ones that buried their children.
Absolutely. And I would bet you that if any one of those men who voted no against that had a child who was killed at Sandy Hook,
they would be standing right there, too.
Nobody's trying to take the gun rights away.
Gail, here we go again. We have a situation where the mother who had a legal right and legally bought her guns and did it, and what does she do? She knows her son is mentally disturbed. Right. She takes him out to the range because she's actually afraid of him. So she wants to befriend him and do things with him and stuff.
So she teaches him how to shoot a gun.
Yesterday, I mean, the bombing, here we go. Not a gun was fired. So, you know, we have violence in our country.
Yes.
And obviously, the majority of it is by guns. So what we need to do, first of all, we're about 20, 30 years behind the times, okay? We should have done things many, many years ago and done that. Now we're trying to put a Band-Aid on a wound that needs 100 stitches.
You're talking about the mental health.
Yeah, and we have mental health issues in this country. And by gosh, all of these killings and the ones that were done, Gabby Giffords and all of these other ones, these people were emotionally and mentally disturbed and had problems. People knew that. So these people can get guns underground. They don't do like Martha and myself and like you who go to a dealer and say, I'd like to purchase a gun. Here's all my information. Do my background check. Call me in 10 days, 2 weeks, whatever it takes, and then let's do this. Okay?
I really worry
You're responsible.
About our government not being able to do that because people that are in jail get all kinds of medical help. You know, but then the people that are really sick outside the prisons.
And people in jail, unfortunately, Martha, and in prison, are getting narcotics.
Sure.
So there you go.
Do you believe
that? It's easier for them to get narcotics in jail.
Interesting. Who supplies them?
My point is that if our government would take care of our mental health, you know, it would be a better world.
We have to start
from
square one.
But it's too easy. It's too common sense. It can't be common sense because our government doesn't understand common sense in many ways.
Well, you have to understand.
Here we go again.
Well, there I go. I said
You have to understand that in dealing with this subject of the mental health, that's an infringement on the mentally ill person's rights for people to suggest that they might have a problem. You do realize that.
Yeah. Yeah.
Next topic.
We're gonna go for your free, you and Gail's free for all, and you wanted to discuss.
Well, this was the free for all.
That was it.
Excuse me, I'm sorry.
We're going to do
the
A New World.
Yes.
Number five. Due to store cameras, pictures were helpful in obtaining important evidence in the Boston Marathon bombing. Do you now feel it is necessary or infringing on your rights?
You know, just like with guns, you know. Why would I be offended if somebody is watching what I'm doing?
Because there are people out there that feel it infringes on your right to privacy. Personally, if it wasn't for these cameras, they probably would have not caught these guys.
Exactly.
Okay.
Exactly.
So, what is the problem? We've had cameras in banks for years that you don't you didn't know.
Sure.
On Main Street in Sutter Creek, there's a live camera cam that goes right down the street.
And I think at first people felt intruded, But I think they're getting used to it now, you know?
Well, all I can say is when I was young, I'm glad they didn't have cameras in parking lots when I was necking with somebody from high school.
There you go.
But there are cameras everywhere. We're not even aware of them.
Absolutely.
Private homes have cameras.
Hey, look. Yeah. There's a satellite that can focus right in my house.
Well, and the other thing is that people walking down the street with their cell phone can take a picture of you.
Everywhere.
Yeah. So,
everywhere.
I mean, I always think about it. If the people who complain the most, I feel, are the people who are concerned about what somebody might see that they're doing.
Yes, exactly. Yeah. Exactly.
I mean, to me, you have...
Because I never even think about it.
I mean, to me, you have your right to privacy. There's no doubt about
it. That's true.
Stores, banks have used...
Are
public places.
Listen. Mm-hmm.
They have used cameras before we were.
I feel that our government has control of so many things that we don't know.
Absolutely.
Oh, that's right.
You know, they can focus in your home. They can put...
Yes,
something
cameras
in your
stores are piddly.
You know, it's, yeah, it's nothing because through your computer, somebody could be watching you.
Mm-hmm. I mean, they've got face recognition where they can take a picture of you
and put it in a data bank. Yeah.
And because of passports and driver's license and everything else,
they know who you are.
They can bring you up in 10 minutes.
Sure.
So, you know, the thing is,
I love our technology. I really do.
I think it's interesting.
I mean, maybe people think it's intruding, but... What the heck do we care? We want to be safe, you know. And if
we have to
do what we have to do,
for instance,
we'll do it.
There was a young man that looked, he was Mid-Eastern, okay, and he had on a blue shirt, and he was talking to two people with baseball caps on, okay? He became a person of interest because they thought, So he's 17 years old. He came forward. He said, I am 17 years old. You're showing my picture. I want to let you know that I was going to run the race, and instead of running the race, I stood on the sidelines and watched the race because I just didn't feel like running. I just wanted to watch it. I'm 17 years old, and because I look Middle Eastern, I'm coming forward. It was kind of like I understood how he felt.
Mm-hmm.
He wanted to clear his name, and in a way it was like, you know, you felt sorry for him.
Yeah.
But by gosh, look at the guts that kid had to come forward and say, hey, I'm here. I'm here legally. I love this country. I'm getting my education. I belong here. And just because I look this way doesn't mean I'm doing
wrong. And when you haven't done anything wrong, you shouldn't be afraid to come forward.
And that's exactly what he did. He came forward. But don't you find that maybe somebody might say that's infringing?
Yes, I can see that it is. And it probably is. But that's kind of human nature that... Unfortunately, I guess trained by culture. Anybody who's different than you, and if it's something that is concerning, I mean, I'm Italian, and I always used to kind of laugh at the term when we're a WOP. Well, do you know what WOP is? It's without papers.
Yeah.
You know, so, and that means that they couldn't afford to pay the Italian government the exorbitant amounts that the Italian government charged Italians who were coming to the United States. So they would simply come and they were WOPs. Well, this became a derogatory statement.
Right.
Why? Because they didn't have enough money to pay for a form.
Here we are, two Italian Stone fans.
Yeah, baby. I have a book that somebody gave me. It was written in the 20s by a judge in New York. And it's kind of very interesting because in one section he says women can't be good witnesses. But he has this whole section on the Malavita, and he refers to the Italians. And in the book he says these horrendous things, like the northern Italians are molto simpatico, but the southern Italians are like animals. And he actually describes them that way and talks about how they behaved. And I thought, this book could never have been printed. I mean, but it shows you how far we have come since the 1920s.
Well, you know, Gail, look at Tom Sawyer and a few of those books where they use derogatory and ugly names and stuff. We're going to take a short break and we'll hit you up with our hot topic when we come back.
Just Between Us. And now back to Just Between Us.
Rawhide.
Oh, we're on. Okay, we're on.
I'm singing Rawhide here. Ready for the... It's been a bad day.
The hot topic.
Fuzzy parts. Things just don't
not
get it.
Not good.
Okay. this is what we're going to do. We're going to continue. We're going to talk about the bombing in Boston. And, Gail, we're going to have you and Pat start us out on your thinking and your feelings on all of this.
Well, it's always a shame when we're attacked on our own soil. It's just coming forward now that there are these two young men. It'll be interesting to see why they would have done something like this. I mean, it's so sad to see this have happened.
I don't think we'll
Boston,
find, well, one is dead, and I think the other one will probably commit suicide.
Right. But I think Boston, it shows the courage that the people in the United States have in a, when something like this happens, how everybody comes and supports them. And Boston is such a strong city and has a strong American background.
Well, I'll tell you what, Gail, I have to say, this man that is burying his little boy has got a daughter that lost a leg and a wife in the hospital with brain injury. This man is probably one of the most bravest men that is walked, like Brian Stowe, that is walking the earth today. And I cannot fathom the pain that this man is going through. I can't. You want to, and you think, just like in Columbine and all of these other places, these babies that were killed and slaughtered, you just cannot imagine what their parents, it's like their hearts being ripped out.
It's horrible.
No.
It's terrible.
Horrible. I cannot even imagine.
I didn't mean to.
No. And I mean, I hearken back to a little bit of Afghanistan about the civilians there who, you know, they love their children the same way we love ours. And that kind of pain is very universal.
Well, and when it happens, when all that bombing happens in Afghanistan, too,
it's terrible.
They just yesterday was in a restaurant, there was a bomb that killed like 26 people.
So many of our,
well,
so
they're finding that these two kids here, they were raised in violence. They were raised where it was nothing to see places where they had 200-300 children and tortured them and killed them. When you're raised like that, I mean, when you come to a place like, why do you think so many people want to come to our country? They just want to live in peace and harmony and to make a living and to support their family. Who wouldn't want to come here?
Well, one of the things that it's kind of interesting because when we had the Trade Center bombing, one of the comments out of Europe and the Middle East was, welcome to our everyday world. And we do not realize, I think, in the United States, because we do not live with this mass, destruction on a day-to-day basis. In Europe and in especially the Middle East, this is like normal life to them.
Sure.
You know, they have bombings here. They have suicide bombers. They have, terrible things going on in London and, in
Ireland.
Ireland lived that way. And we have been very, very lucky. Yes, we have things like Columbine and the World Trade Center and things like that, but we do not have nearly what Europe and the rest of the world deals with all the time. And I think what's sad about it is that I think they looked at us and said, ha, 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 you finally, are getting some of us.
Welcome to our
because,
world.
Because, you don't really understand. You can empathize, but you can't sympathize until it's happened.
Right. Close
to you.
And like Gail said, now that it's hit on our soil, we really, really, we're starting to really feel 9/11 put everybody, I mean, it stopped everybody in their tracks for days. You were just glued to the television thinking, what the hell just happened?
I always tell everybody, we have to be vigilant
within
ourselves. I mean, I always tell everybody, just watch and look around and, you can see when something is
wrong. Well, this is exactly what they said.
If it gives you a gut feeling, if it gives you a bad gut feeling,
isn't it a shame we have to live that way, though?
Usually when I have that gut feeling, it's Ashina or gas. What can I say?
No, but I mean, I'm talking about
it is.
Truly, all of us should, be watching each other, because you can tell when somebody is, I don't have a wet back, do I?
God love you.
That was a whopper.
But I know my husband is always, he says, you have this
odd way to figure out what people are going to do before they do it. And I've always been this way.
I think it's a gut feeling that we get and a feeling that you know what should be happening. Like if I go to a game, you know, and...
Right, you sense something.
You sense something, you know, for God's sakes, you know, let somebody know.
We have to go to a short break, but listen to this, Pat.
Oh, no.
We hope that these honky-tonk women brought you some satisfaction.
Yes.
We'll be right back.
And now back to Just Between Us.
Hey, you can get us at 223-4877 if you have Stones tickets. Pat and I are right there. You can fax us at 223-4866, or you can email us at bookme@tspntv.com. And it's only rock and roll,
yes,
but we like it.
Yes. I want to say happy birthday to my daughter,
Leticia.
Martha Leticia. She's in San Diego. She's probably watching.
Happy birthday to you today, Leticia.
Happy birthday.
Yesterday.
Besitos. Besitos.
Muchos besitos, mija.
Absolutely.
And I also wanted to say Alicia Drake.
Yes.
You know, I'm so happy.
I'm glad she didn't go to the Boston Marathon this year.
You know, well, you know.
I really am.
I really worried because I really didn't know whether she was there or not because she was there last year.
Oh, last year. Yes, absolutely.
So
we watched
I
to
was
make.
Very glad to.
No, I'm glad she stayed home this year.
Get in contact with her that she was home. Yeah.
Very happy. She's one of our girls here. Gail, it was so nice to see you today.
Well, thank you for inviting me on the show. I'm glad I finally got a chance to meet you. Donna speaks very, very highly.
Well, I love
you.
Donna.
Hi, Donna.
I love Donna.
Hi, Donna.
I hope she's watching. She's my partner in crime.
Yes. She's in Washington, right?
She'll be home soon, and we love and miss you dearly, and give Kyle a big hug for us, because I know that he might be going back to Afghanistan. To Jesse, who's in Afghanistan, we send our love to all of our boys and girls in service.
Adriana just wrote a little book about her story with Jesse.
Wonderful.
You know, and Donna is going to help her, you know.
Good.
Put it all together.
Donna's going to come and do some military stuff for us.
Yes.
Patricia, as always, it's lovely to see you.
Nice
now that
hear.
I've got a rock and roll chick on my side here. Boy, I'll tell you.
Uh-huh. I will tell you a sad story. I had a ticket to go to see the first Beatles concert at the Hollywood Bowl, and I got to the point where I said, I don't think I want to go. And so it was sitting in my drawer for years.
And I'm
thinking, how could I have done that? But I was 15. So it's like, you know.
Yeah.
You can probably sell that ticket now for a lot of money.
Well, I think I finally threw it away. You do not carry lots of stuff around when you move 29 times.
Yeah. No, and Pat has moved 29 times.
Oh, goodness. My God.
Yes.
Actually, I forgot one thing. I told Taylor that I think we've moved 30 times.
Oh, my God.
Don't tell him. It'll upset him.
Okay.
No.
Besitos to all my grandkids.
Yes,
besitos. And my daughter and my son.
And Raylene, I'm proud of you. She knows exactly the reason why I love you, dear.
I love everybody.
Besitos.
Muchos besitos.